Hi, I'm Kate Griffith. I'm going to be moderating the panel, and I'm currently an associate professor of labor and employment law up at Cornell University and an associate of the Worker Institute at Cornell. But probably the most relevant aspect of my bio today is that I'm the former editor-in-chief of this fine Review of Law and Social Change. I just wanted to, a lot has been said already about the journal, but for me it's a real point of pride on my time here and to be invited back to participate in this symposium. I think the mission of the Review of Law and Social Change is as important today as it was in the 1960s when it was founded by a small group of radical students, which is to develop and then promote quality scholarship that addresses social injustice in its many forms. So thank you to Leo and to the review for putting this together. I'm only the moderator, but I'm going to take advantage of the role a little bit to give a few introductory remarks, and then I'll turn it over to our distinguished panelists. So as you know, this panel is focusing on labor law and alt labor, which I will sometimes refer loosely to worker centers as worker centers, even though I know these terms are very imperfect. But one of the things I wanted to put out there and put in people's minds is that when we think about alt labor in comparison to traditional labor unions, they're very different institutions in a number of ways. They look, and I'm generalizing here, which is really bad to do with worker centers because there's so much diversity, but generally speaking, they tend to look more like nonprofits than traditional labor organizations. And one of the ways where you can see this is if we look at it looks like my slide's having trouble. I'll give you the the parts that are missing. But where they're getting funding from, worker centers, as opposed to traditional labor unions. So this research I'm doing with a group of students through the Worker Institute is using publicly available data to just try to get a sense of where are the funding streams coming from for worker centers. And the funding picture so far, this is preliminary data, but it paints an interesting picture. One is that worker centers, if we look at them as a group, again, if we looked at one individual worker center, it might be a little different, but if we look at them as a group, only 3% of the funding for worker centers is coming from member dues. And this is a radically different than traditional labor unions, where 90 to 95%, sometimes even higher than 95% of a revenue base for labor unions is from member dues. Pause.
Did I do something when I moved the laptop?
Oh, no, it's unconnected. Sliver at the bottom, that's the member dues percentage of 3%. The other thing this shows is there is some diversity in funding streams. Some people like to say, oh, it's all foundation funding, but if we look at worker centers as a group, there is a variety. So the yellow piece, which again somehow got cut off what the category is, but that's government grants. 15% is coming from government grants. 16%, which is the sort of royal blue below the government grants, is coming from program service revenue. So when a worker center is doing a service and receiving money in exchange for that service, 16% is coming from there. The top 20%, the orange sliver, that's foundation funding, and that's probably underrepresenting the total percentage. We're still working on that, but at least 20% is coming from foundations. So besides diversity in funding sources, the other thing that our research is showing is that most worker centers, not all, but most, are small. They're grassroots. Some of them aren't even filing with the IRS, so we can't get any data because they're just so small. But even the ones that are filing with the IRS, which is where some of this data comes from, the median revenue is around $400,000. Just pennies if you compare it to unions with revenues in the millions and sometimes hundreds of millions for the bigger ones. Okay, so how does this relate to labor law? Well, one thing is that generally, and again, I'm generalizing here because some worker centers do engage in collective bargaining, but most don't. Most worker centers, at least in their current form, are not engaging in collective bargaining, not interested necessarily in trying to get a collective bargaining agreement and then service it. So the aspects of labor law that have to do with the collective bargaining process tend to not be as relevant to worker centers. But while this is a difference between worker centers and traditional labor unions, these institutions share a common goal in improving working lives and engaging in organizing to improve workplace conditions. And so the aspects of labor law that give employees rights to engage in collective activity, at least theoretically, should be relevant to worker centers and should help them when they face retaliation from employers for engaging in such collective activity. Those of you who are familiar with labor law know, at least in how it's written, it's pretty broad in its protections. The CLE paper that I submitted for this panel, those of you who have had a chance to look at it or might get a chance to look at it, you'll see that worker centers that have gone to the National Labor Relations Board in the face of employer retaliation have unanimously been successful. They've received favorable rulings from the board. But it's a small grouping, at least what's publicly available. We're talking about a dozen or so cases. So despite the broad definitions and the board's favorable rulings, most worker centers currently do not turn to the National Labor Relations Board or see labor law as a friend, to harken back to the title of our panel. So this panel is going to discuss the opportunities and challenges for alt labor to work within the current strictures of labor law, but also to work outside of it in certain contexts. So we have a great group of panelists. I'm just going to very briefly introduce them. I encourage you, if you haven't already, to read their full bios, and you'll see how lucky we are to have their minds talking to us about this issue. First, we're going to have Wilma Liebman. She's the former chairperson of the National Labor Relations Board, where she served three terms. Since then, she's been teaching in a number of places, including NYU Law School. And I had the fortune of having the office next to her when she was at Cornell a few years ago. Our second speaker is going to be Ingrid Nava. She's the Associate General Counsel of SEIU 32BJ. She's also the founding board member of Justice at Work, an organization that provides strategic advice to worker centers. Third, we're going to have Tsedeye, Gebreselassie, a senior staff attorney at the National Employment Law Project, also former social changer from the Review of Law and Social Change. And finally, we'll have Stephen Greenhouse, a longtime journalist from the New York Times, and currently a visiting researcher at Russell Sage, where he's working on his second book. He's an NYU law grad and also worked for the Review of Law and Social Change. Do I have that right, Stephen? Yes. So we're dominating the panel with three members. Everyone's included. Okay, so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Wilma. And I think we'll hear from everyone, and then we'll have some time for questions at the end.
Thank you, Kate, and thanks to Leo and the Law Review for putting this together and inviting all of us to participate. So I thought what I would do is start with just some general impressions and maybe some framing of the question. And it's probably not the way it was put on the program, a friend or a foe, and I guess I'd answer both to that. But I am repeatedly asked whether the National Labor Relations Act is still relevant. And for years and years and years, academics have been writing articles using the vocabulary of death and dying. Cindy Eslin here, who will be moderating a panel this afternoon, wrote her very well-known article about the ossification of American labor law. In 1981, Harvard Law professor Paul Weiler wrote a piece which started in the first sentence about an elegant tombstone for a dying institution. But I guess my words of advice, particularly for law students and people just going into this field, is I'm not dead yet. So I think it's good news, bad news. A few years ago, a Washington Post opinion writer said, the good news about the economy, or the reason for optimism, is that people are finally realizing how bad things have been for several decades for American workers. And I think there are two reasons why they're finally realizing it. One is that we are seeing emerging worker activism that I really don't remember seeing like this really in a long time, maybe in my professional lifetime. It's probably not yet to the level of 1930s labor struggles or 1960s civil rights struggles, but I think it is quite remarkable. After years of marginalization with issues about labor law and labor policy being marginalized in the public policy discourse. So number one, I think we have worker activism coupled with the attention that the press is giving it. I give Steve Greenhouse enormous credit for his relentless coverage and wonderful storytelling of the lives of workers and their different kinds of campaigns. And I think Steve would agree there's an emerging group of young labor reporters who are also passionately covering these stories. Another reason, I think, for the growing awareness is that labor law has been controversial over the last 5 to 10 years. And all these controversies have also gotten a lot of media attention. So there was a time a few years ago where coupled with the controversy about the NLRB, some of you may even remember the controversy about the general counsel's decision to prosecute the Boeing Corporation, which got enormous press, triggered enormous controversy. But at the same time, there was also ongoing collective bargaining disputes in most major league sports. And I remember saying at the time that if people had not heard the words collective bargaining, they were really kind of half asleep because it was so prominent in the news. So I think that's the good news. In the last few years, we've seen labor disputes in the ports on the West Coast, Texas oil fields, a New England telephone company. We've seen drivers who transport Silicon Valley entrepreneurs to and from work vote to join the Teamsters and a coalition of community and religious and labor organizations working to further their collective bargaining causes. We've seen efforts by people who are excluded from the law to organize, mobilize, and try to improve their conditions of employment. So there are various forms of organization by farm workers who have been excluded from the law since 1935. There's the regulated model in California. There's the unregulated model that the Farm Labor Organizing Committee follows. And then there's a more alternative model, which I think others will talk about, the Coalition of Immokalee Workers. We've seen efforts by home health care aides to organize using very innovative forms of employment status and organization. So a lot of innovation, a lot of experimentation. Obviously, drivers for Uber are following different approaches to try to organize for better terms and conditions of employment with an effort in Seattle to provide for collective bargaining based on independent contractor status, and a recent petition filed with the NLRB here in New York to try to organize Uber drivers at LaGuardia. So lots of experimentation, a lot of innovation, which I think is great. One size does not fit all. So all this multiplicity of approaches, I think, is terrific. I think it's important to recognize that there are constraints under labor law. And whether it's your friend or foe, it just, you know, it depends. I once was at a conference, and I asked two people on a panel, one with the Guest Worker Alliance and one with an SEIU local on the West Coast. I said, do you view labor law as unhelpful, or is it really an obstacle? The SEIU president said it's an obstacle. The Guest Worker Alliance lawyer said it's sometimes helpful. We'll use it when we can, and I think that's really the bottom line. You have to have a lot of different tools at your disposal. Use them when they help. Do something else when they don't help. But certainly the law, from my perspective, the law is never, ever a substitute for organizing and mobilizing people. So just very quickly, I think there are enduring values to this law which are as vital today as they were in 1935. And they are important in framing our legal culture, whether you use the NLRB or not. And I think people might identify those enduring values differently, but here are mine. Number one, we have a rule of law that substituted for many, many years of violent, bloody struggles over the desire of people to have representation at work. So the rule of law. The freedom of association that is enshrined in this law, the right of people to come together to organize and bargain collectively. The notion of economic advance through collective action is really quite unique in this statute, protecting collective rights, very different than the other workplace statutes that are based either on individual rights or some protection of against discrimination based on identity. And the fourth enduring value that I would identify is basically this notion of industrial democracy, the notion of self-governance at the workplace. And so those enduring values I think we should keep in mind as we proceed, because while our law is sometimes honored in the breach, while there are lapses in the way the NLRB enforces the law, oftentimes it takes way too long to decide a case. Sometimes you don't win. Sometimes the board majority lacks administrative will to really make the law work. But nonetheless, we have this law on the books, and it contains principles which are really at the cornerstone of labor rights internationally. So let me conclude by just saying there are constraints. One has to be realistic. And those constraints would be, number one, we have, I don't think a dying law, but an aging law, written for an industrial era with a factory in mind and certain assumptions about the employment model that don't hold true very much anymore. The notion of lifetime employment with hierarchies in an organization, promotion ladders, the notion that you would get health care and retirement and then retire with Social Security. So we have an aging statute. The definitions of employee, employer are often a mismatch with the realities of the way business models are put together today and employment relationships are structured. We have 80 years of precedent that has to be navigated. The board is, of course, free to change its precedent as long as it gives reasons and explains what it's doing. But nonetheless, it has to be careful in doing that and carefully navigate. There's also the constraint imposed by the constant review of the courts, which are often unversed in this statute, particularly as the courts see fewer cases. So they are unversed in notions of collective action, much more familiar with individual rights. Sometimes the courts are skeptical of these notions and of what the NLRB is doing, and sometimes they're outright hostile. Nonetheless, the board's cases receive overwhelming approval in the courts, but the court review is a constraint at times. And then there are external constraints, including the fact that this nation is deeply divided on many issues, and certainly none more than issues that concern labor rights. So deep divisions, which translates to a lot of political controversy, attacks on the NLRB, its budgets, its appointments, its doctrines over labor law reform. It's been impossible to reform this law for decades and decades and decades. Every effort, including the most recent one, which people were optimistic about, the Employee Free Choice Act, has ended up in gridlock in the Senate because of the deep divides over these issues. So, yes, we need a stronger labor law. Are we going to see one soon? I guess that sort of depends, but probably unlikely. But I think it's important, and this is the last thing I'll say, to remember that a stronger labor law will come about because of a stronger worker movement. That the law didn't create labor power, labor did. So, and I think it would follow from increased worker activism. And if anyone doubts that worker activism is a factor that shouldn't be ignored, they're missing the presidential campaign. So, thank you.
Thank you. And I'll just start also by saying that, I am a labor lawyer. I work for SEIU Local 32BJ. I was a union organizer for 8 years prior to going to law school. And so very much my perspective is informed by that experience as well as my current experience as a lawyer. And I'm going to focus most of my comments today on stories and experience that I've had as a founding board member of Justice at Work, which is a legal organization that provides counsel and, as Kate said, strategic advice to worker centers in the Boston area and Massachusetts, New Bedford area as well. The question of the panel is friend or foe, and I think I would agree with Wilma that it could be both or either, depending on how you avail yourself of the law. But to me, there's really no inside or outside, labor organization, friend or foe, or non or alternative labor organization, friend or foe. It's sort of the same thing because the NLRA really regulates concerted action. And so to the extent that workers are taking concerted action, they have to understand and know what is provided, what protections are provided by the law, and what the issues are that they could run into as well. And I just want to tell a few stories that can illustrate that. So Justice at Work, the organization in Boston, gives counsel to a lot of area worker centers, and they have three cases, recent cases, where they filed charges at the board. The first was with a group of car wash employees who actually had overtime claims. But in addition to overtime claims and taking those claims, they did a delegation to the boss, and they talked about not only the overtime claims but some of the health and safety concerns. Apparently, I don't know that much about car washes, but they had to go underneath where the cars go and clean out whatever's underneath there. And they had safety concerns about that. They were the same group that went into the boss, which is a group of about four workers, were fired shortly thereafter. So in addition to adding an anti-retaliation claim to their wage claims, they also filed with the board. In that, what ultimately happened was that was withdrawn by the workers because the employer had a right line defense. They were able to show some evidence that they'd been planning to do layoffs anyway, and these were the people that they were going to lay off. I don't know what the real merits of that were or not, but I guess my point would be that's exactly the same sort of analysis that any union would face if they were trying to organize workers and bringing that sort of claim to the board as well. Justice at Work also worked with a group of workers at a seafood packing plant. Out of this location, there were two board charges that were brought. One was where a worker who had been involved in organizing at the workplace had another coworker post a Facebook post about her and about the union activity with regard to that, and or not the union activity, but the concerted action. And she was fired. That was also withdrawn for lack of evidence. And I don't know a whole lot more about that. out of that same workplace, there had been a delegation to management and a petition that was written up and presented, and the petition named healthcare issues about scheduling and shifts, an issue about a supervisor. This was actually an issue where the workers favored a supervisor who had been discharged and wanted that supervisor to come back, which is interesting because, of course, that's, you know, a management decision. It's not a protected. That by itself wouldn't have protected them. And they had some other dignity and respect, sort of general issues on the petition as well. In that, out of that charge, complaint was issued. And ultimately, the employer settled. It involved six workers. Two got front pay in addition to their back pay because they did not get reinstatement or were foregoing reinstatement. And the others got reinstatement as well as the back pay. So I tell these stories to show that all of those things that these workers did are exactly the same kinds of things that union employees would do. And the analysis in determining whether or not these charges were going to go to complaint or not is exactly the same sort of analysis that would be used for union employees. So the question for me, really, when we think about whether or not the law can be useful to alternative labor organizations or worker centers, is a question about what do these worker centers want? What is the goal of what they're trying to do? And can they avail themselves of the law, or can the law be helpful for them in achieving those goals? So one of the things that's interesting to me is that in the seafood packing plant, as I said, there was a petition brought to the boss. It included healthcare issues. It included issues about shifts. And it's not clear after reinstatement and after back pay that those particular issues are any better. What the employees really, I think, want is some ongoing assurance that when they bring these issues, or raise them, that they can have them addressed, and or some other kind of firm assurance from the employer that they won't face the same kind of health and safety issues that they've had in the past, or that they could get to an agreement between the two of them on exactly how scheduling and shifts are managed. That kind of ongoing assurance would require a contract. And that they didn't get because they were not collectively bargaining with the employer around these. And so for them, the real challenge is that in order to continue, they would say they had success, I think, out of this. But in order to continue to have assurance that they are not going to face the same issues in the future, in order to get an enforceable something more than a promise from the employer on scheduling or any other of the workplace issues, without having a contract, they have to continually engage in this direct action and continually to have some level of labor unrest. And, you know, the question, I think, for these alternative labor organizations and where and how the law fits in is that sustainable? And if it's not, how do we, you know, short of a contract, is there any other method by which workers can get what they want? And I don't know that there is. I don't have the answers. But that, to me, is the crux of the question about a alternative labor organization versus a labor union. And so then back to the issue of how is this distinct from a labor union, I would just say, even given what I just said, I don't think it's that distinct. If you look at SEIU, almost all of the, well, I think all of the labor organizing that has been done on any large scale in SEIU, going back to the 90s, has been done in a way that's not necessarily prescribed by the NLRA. So for those of you familiar with Justice for Janitors and how that started back in the 90s or late 80s, it's a campaign that we did not do through election, SEIU did not do through election, where the bargaining units are not building per building, which is the default recognized appropriate unit under the act, and where the union really, the way I describe it, really learned how to ride the line between what was impermissible secondary activity and permissible secondary pressure. That was Justice for Janitors. That the home health that Wilma mentioned is another example of where, one, you create an employer that didn't previously exist or wasn't recognized, and don't go through election. We organized security and building services. That was the next big, after Justice for Janitors, it was the next big effort across the country. Security again, and we're organizing security into the same locals where we have janitors. For those of you not familiar with the NLRA, I mean, that by itself to start with was an issue. Again, we're not going through election. And currently we are in building services organizing at the airports. Organizing employees of contractors who contract with airlines. So a ton of issues there. Again, no election. Potentially, an issue around what the appropriate bargaining unit is, and this is not an NLRA issue, but there was a threshold issue, or potentially still is, I guess, but I think we're winning on it, which is what is the proper jurisdiction, and does the National Labor Relations Board, rather than the NMB under the Railway Labor Act, which has jurisdiction there. You know, we've been arguing that the NLRB does under the NLRA, and I think we're winning on that, but that is a threshold issue there. So all of that is to say that, SEIU, which I think is we certainly claim that we're the fastest growing union and most organizing union, is organizing in a way that is not prescribed per se by the NLRA. We certainly avail ourselves of all of the protections that it has and use it where appropriate. We did run an election recently. Votes will be counted on Monday at a unit out of Logan Airport. It's a combined unit, Logan Airport and DC National and BWI. We'll do it where it makes sense, but it is part of a bigger effort that's not where the path is not straight and narrow.
Tsedeye from National Employment Law Project.
Hello. Okay. I have to put it close because I talk softly. So my name is Tsedeye. I'm from the National Employment Law Project. I'm actually not really a labor lawyer, but I work with state and local groups, worker centers, community groups on policies to raise job standards and enforce them. So that's kind of my orientation and how I'm coming at this. And I did, when I was looking at some of the literature around this, I found the ossification language. I did not find the tombstone language, which is great. I found language telling us as a labor movement to stop the self-flagellation. So there's lots of people telling us to, don't despair. But I do think that in general, there is a consensus that the traditional union movement is in a deep crisis, and it's really, without change, no longer able to deliver for all of America's workers to protect our interests. And with the scale and power necessary to really reverse these awful economic trends that we're finding ourselves in. And so I think the question for us is, can we revive it to scale, even if there were improvements in the NLRA framework, which may or may not be likely? If we can't, is there something that replaces it? What are parts that we can still use? And I think that these are questions that ALOs or alternative labor or worker centers, many of whom I see in this room, so they can tell me if I'm wrong, but many of these questions are questions that they're grappling with. So I think in my allotted time, I wanted to give just very quick context for the rise of worker centers, which is my shorthand for all of the groups that are doing this work, if you don't mind, just to make it easier. How they're working, Ingrid talked a lot about how they're working within the NLRA, so I'll focus on how they're working outside the NLRA and some of the challenges, the many challenges, and what that means for the future of alternative labor. So just some context, you know, at the high water mark, as we all knew, unions represented 40% of America's workers, and that density didn't just mean that they were setting good wages and standards for those workers, they were saturating the market and basically forcing non-union employers to do the same. And the fact that they had so much political power also meant that they had a seat at the table as political leaders were developing national economic policy. So it was, you know, power on both levels. So what's changed? I'll just do like a 1-minute version, which I'm sure everybody knows. But one is, you know, this CBA model this of the 19th century that assumed, you know, mass industrial production, large vertical corporations where you had a single employer where you were there forever. You know, that's not the case anymore, and that has really important implications for how worker power can be aggregated. You know, there are growing numbers of workers who are not covered by the NLRA, everybody from low-wage supervisors at fast food restaurants to farm workers to domestic workers, independent contractors, even the workers that are covered. You know, organizing may be a practical impossibility given dispersed workplaces or any other situations. The NLRA itself has been weakened, and there's been this, I mean, everybody knows, but this right-wing corporate assault on unions that we are losing if we haven't already lost, you know? We're not just losing it through right-to-work laws and litigation, but we're losing it through this media and culture war that tells us that unions are selfish, corrupt, lazy, and the cause of our economic recession. We have anti-union think tanks and PR firms, union avoidance consultants. This is a booming industry, and it's a vicious cycle because we don't have labor law reform. Without labor law reform, unions shrink. But as union power shrinks, it becomes even harder to win labor law reform. And then we have a narrative where there are the heroic job creators, and our side has adopted this too, and those that get in the way of job creators, and that's us, and that's the labor movement. So I think this is the context that worker centers have come into and are trying to fill some gaps. So I just want to talk a bit about how, I'll skip this, how we're working outside the NLRA context. I think one thing is figuring out, especially for workers who aren't covered by the NLRA, standard setting legislation to basically raise industry standards. So I know folks are familiar with Domestic Workers United. In New York, after a 6-year campaign, they passed something called the Domestic Worker Bill of Rights. You know, they're the type of industry where it's almost impossible to bargain contracts with individual employers, right? Because you're talking about being in somebody's home where it's very difficult to organize across, I mean, talk about dispersed workplaces. So they thought about what's a way that we can get something that raises standards in the industry. I think there, this is a challenge and a lesson for future. You know, it was worker-led, but it did not rely, I don't think, on, you know, very large-scale mass mobilization, again, because it couldn't. So it used the power that and the tools that it had at the time. So advocacy, media, alliances with labor, obviously, and got something that is good, but now the question is, how do we make it better, and how do we enforce it, which is what Ingrid was talking about, as I agree, kind of the crux of the question. I think, you know, there are examples of organizations like ROC that are essentially winning contract-like terms in settlement negotiations. And then I think the last thing I want to talk about, and a given time, is just the Fight for 15 movement. You know, I don't know if people remember SeaTac Washington, but SeaTac was the first $15 ballot initiative. I think the way that they got there is instructive. You know, a decade ago, the airlines that SeaTac laid off unionized workers, workers that were making $20, $25 an hour, and replaced them with subcontracted workers that were making barely above minimum wage then, so like nine bucks an hour. For a variety of reasons, it was hard for the unions to organize those workers, many of whom actually worked for the $20, $25 an hour, got laid off, and then came back and were working at $9, $10 an hour. So there was a coalition in Seattle of all of the different unions that had, you know, interest in all of the different sectors, partnering with, you know, faith, Muslim community, because it was a huge Ethiopian and Somali community that was working at the SeaTac airport, with Enviro groups, I mean, everybody. And then we're like, you know what? We are going to put corporate pressure on Alaska Airlines, which was one of the main opponents. They tried that. That didn't work. And then they were like, all right, plan C. We're going to do a ballot initiative, $15 an hour. And they launched this massive voter registration drive. I mean, they registered 1,000 voters. The margin of victory was 70 votes. Only 6,000 people voted, which was probably like a 1,000,000% increase from past elections. And they won. Of course, the challenge, and then that, you know, kicked off the whole fight for, or not, you know, was one of the catalysts for Fight for 15, which is such an amazing movement today. The challenge, though, is that, you know, that was a very labor-intensive campaign. The union, if I understand it correctly, you know, flew in a lot of organizers, maybe 100 or so, the weekend before the election. And so the question is, well, how do you sustain that? And I think the challenge for all of these, or a lot of these alt-labor campaigns, is to the extent that they're mostly won in the realm of legislation and policy, you know, what are the implications for that going forward? I think the question that Ingrid raised is exactly the right one, is that, you know, workers can't enforce a lot of these rights without going to court, without going to a public agency. So how do we figure out how workers can enforce them in a sustaining way going forward, and how do we build to scale, especially given, you know, Kate's numbers about how these organizations are funded? You know, we obviously can't rely on philanthropy, as great as they are, for, you know, funding a revolution. So.
Steve?
I'm going to stand up.
Great.
I got tired of sitting. Forgive me. So history repeating itself. So once upon a time, Kent Hirazawa was editor of, a classmate of mine at NYU Law School, was co-editor-in-chief of the Review and Law of Social Change, and he said, Steve wanted to come join the staff and we will organize a big conference about labor. And we, in 1982, we did a big conference called the Colloquium, the Labor Movement at the Crossroads. So plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. You know, the more things change, the more things remain the same. So title of the conference, rather than the title of the panel, you know, can alt labor revive the labor movement? Yes and no. Can it, you know, so 6.7% of American workers are now, private sector workers are now in labor unions. In the 1950s, it was 35%. So my sense is, you know, no matter how effective alt labor is, you know, it's not going to make the traditional labor movement grow back to 15, 20, 25% of the workforce. Alt labor, though, is giving the traditional labor movement a kick in the pants, a much needed kick in the pants, I believe. I think the traditional labor movement realizes that it has to get more active, it has to reach out more to other organizations. And then when we say, when you ask, can alternative labor revive the labor movement, it raises the question, what do we even mean by labor movement? Does it mean the traditional labor movement, the AFL-CIO, you know, American Federation of Teachers, the United Steelworkers, or does it mean general worker advocacy in the United States? And I think that raises broad questions. So Leo mentioned, and I want to mention again, today is the 105th anniversary of the Triangle Fire, Shirtwaist Fire. And some of you know, but many of you don't know, that that fire took place about 300 yards from here, just east of Washington Square, in a building now owned by NYU for use for biology and chemistry labs. And the Triangle Fire is, in ways, you know, a tragic but important example of the importance of worker voice and worker organizing. As Leo mentioned, And you know, Leo's done it, and Leo and the review have done a terrific job organizing this. I should have prefaced my remarks by saying that. You know, there was a huge strike, historic strike, the largest strike by women in American history in 1909, the uprising of the 20,000. Well, most of that happened about 300, 400 yards east of here in the Lower East Side in the East Village. And these 20,000 women went on strike for a 52-hour week, for they were tired of having to pay for the thread and needles that they had to pay for their own thread and needles at the garment shops. And they basically won the strike, but the company that led the employer effort to defeat the strike was the Triangle Company. And almost, you know, 90-95% of the companies after the strike recognized the union, but Triangle was a holdout. So when you look at the causes of the Triangle fire, you could many ways see it was, you know, there was a lack of worker voice was a big factor. They had, you know, this infamous door that was locked that prevented dozens of workers to, you know, from escaping to the stairwells. They had all these scraps. They hadn't picked up the scraps of cotton for over 2 months. There was a ton of scraps just lying around on the floor. So when the fire started, it quickly became an inferno. Government inspectors had recommended that they carry out fire drills. They never held fire drills. You know, the tallest ladders at the time in New York City, tallest fire ladders went to the sixth floor. This factory was on the eighth, ninth, and tenth floor. So you can imagine that if, you know, there was a union, if there were a real worker voice, a lot of this might have been avoided. So now I'm going to fast forward 100 years. So you know, we're talking a lot about alt labor, and we should also remember that, you know, in certain pockets of the economy, traditional labor organizing, traditional collective bargaining is doing very well. And I think about, you know, there's been a burst of organizing in digital media right now, in Gawker and Huffington Post and Think Progress. And, you know, Gawker has, you know, got a terrific contract. And, you know, here are all these, you know, 20-somethings who think that the business is too unstable, too volatile, and they thought we could use a union. So they got raises of 3% a year for 3 years. They got these minimums, which is like unheard of in digital media. You know, 50,000 for everyone, absolute minimum, even the people who answer the phones. 70,000 for senior writers. You know, they established a right for workers to go in and meet with their bosses at least once a year to discuss bonuses and raises. And we talk a lot about the freelance economy. If you're a freelancer there for more than a year, working full-time as a freelancer, they have to decide whether to hire you as a permanent or let you go so you're not in purgatory the whole time. Another very successful unionization drive led by SEIU, over 10,000 adjunct faculty have been unionized in the past 2-3 years. So at Tufts University, you know, so the average pay for adjunct professors in the United States is $2,700 a course. And if you're teaching a 13-week course and spending 15, 20 hours a week on the course, you know, your pay might come to $15, sometimes $10 an hour. It's pretty crazy. So they should join the fight for $15. So at Tufts University, as a result of the adjunct's new contract, many professors are getting a bump in pay of 40%. Lesley University in Boston, most adjunct faculty will get a 33% increase per course. Another successful unionization drive, as I think you mentioned, Wilma. So the shuttle bus drivers in Silicon Valley, they were generally being paid $17 to $19 an hour, which sounds pretty good, but when you realize how insane the housing costs are there, where it's hard to get an apartment for less than $5,000, sounds a little like New York. So under this new contract that the Teamsters got for Apple, PayPal, Yahoo, Genentech, eBay drivers, their pay basically goes from $17-$19 an hour to $24-$31 an hour. And for the first time, they're getting paid holidays. They're getting 10 paid holidays. They used to have to pay 70% of the cost of family. They used to pay 70% of the cost of family health insurance. Now they only have to pay 30%, which is still high, but it shows that, you know, traditional organizing can work. So alt labor everyone's talked about, you know, various efforts, and the most important thing is, and Tsedeye has said, you know, is achieving power, scale, and sustainability. And there are a lot of alt labor groups. In the first panel we talked about this excellent effort to organize car wash workers here, and you have three terrific organizations: Make the Road, the Retail Wholesale Department Store Union, and New York Communities for Change. They spent 2-3 years using a lot of bodies and a lot of money, and they've organized, what, 200 workers? I don't know the exact number. And that's all laudable, but it shows how hard it is. It's so important to talk about scale. And Wilma mentioned this group, the Coalition of Mockley Workers, which, you know, in my view, has been the most successful non-union worker effort, worker center in the country. And it was founded in Immokalee, this tiny, tiny town in Florida, and it's won improvements for like 30,000 immigrant tomato workers. The bulk of them are undocumented. And it was founded by several young people who decided to move down there, Brown College graduates or some other people. And they held strikes, they organized a co-op to get the community to, you know, feel more comfortable with this worker effort. They have a low wattage radio station that all these farm workers listen to. They act outside the National Labor Relations Act because and Wilma's plays a very important role in the effort. They use secondary boycotts. Secondary boycotts are you're not organizing a boycott against the farmer you work for, but you're organizing a boycott against Taco Bell or McDonald's, and they've used that extremely successfully. And as a result, they've been able to raise standards and wages of 30,000 tomato workers and now 10,000 pepper workers. And they've gotten Walmart to sign on, and Walmart is extending this effort, to protect, strawberry workers in New Jersey. Another very successful effort is the Los Angeles Alliance for a New Economy, which is founded by labor unions, but labor unions realized that they did not have the power and in ways the public credibility to do what they thought was needed to improve wages. So LANE, Los Angeles Alliance for New Economy, worked very closely with African American groups, Hispanic groups, clergy, Asian American groups, and they formed this huge coalition that, for instance, got Long Beach, California to pass a referendum that raised hotel wages to $13 for all the city's hotel workers. That became the precedent for SeaTac in Seattle. And they got, they were the major force to get Los Angeles to pass the $15 minimum wage, and before that, the $15.37 wage for hotel workers. And a lot of it, we could talk about, can alt-labor succeed inside or outside the National Labor Relations Act, but so much is, the importance of strategy, of good organizing, of working with outsiders. As Julie said in the first panel, you have to fight with them for their fights, and then they'll come and fight for you on your fights. And it's very important for the with labor representing just 6.7% of the private sector, it's extremely important to develop partnerships. One more minute. So I was out in Seattle, and there is a fascinating new law there that the city council passed to enable Uber and Lyft drivers to unionize. And that's considered extraordinary because by many measures, they're considered independent contractors. And the National Labor Relations Act specifically excludes independent contractors from unionizing. But the Seattle City Council says because they're excluded, we at the state level and city level have the right, have the power to grant them the ability to unionize. And the Chamber of Commerce has sued saying, no, you don't have that right. It's preempted by the National Labor Relations Act. And besides, if you let independent contractors bargain for wages or fares or whatever, that violates the Antitrust Act. So that's a very creative, interesting, controversial move. I will end there. I spoke too long. I'm sorry.
All right. So we have a little bit more than 10 minutes for questions. And I thought if we could collect some questions from the audience, that would be great. And give our panelists a chance to respond? Anybody? While you're thinking of questions, one thing that I think a lot about is if there was a world where legislative reform occurred and it could support alt-labor more in its organizing, what kinds of legislative changes to labor law or federal law more broadly might be useful in supporting these efforts to bring strategies to scale in the face of challenge. Does anybody on the panel have any thoughts about this what this would be if we could get such a reform?
Well, I'll say a little bit of what I said before, which is I'm not sure that there's a distinction between what favorable changes would be for alt labor organizations versus any for real labor organizations or labor organizations recognized under the Act. The issues about secondary boycott, to me, they're outdated. The prohibition on secondary boycott was written at a time where the distinction between an employer and a business relationship that employer had with another entity was more distinct than it is today in many, if not most, employment situations. So that, I feel like, should be revisited generally, and certainly, in SEIU, all of those, justice for janitors, security, the airport, those are all situations in which that would be something that would be helpful to those campaigns as well. And I think other things that people have brought up in the past, it's hard to even entertain them because we seem so far away from any real labor reform. But whether or not there could be punitive damages, for example, for unfair labor practices, I mean, that's something that's going to be applicable to anybody. The changes that would also, the issue of Hoffman and the inability of undocumented workers to get a real remedy, that obviously is going to impact both workers in and out of unions as well. So
if you look at public opinion polls, they show that 75 to 25, 80 to 20 Americans favor a 10-10 minimum wage. Forget about 15. By around the same margins, they want Congress to pass paid sick days. Around the same margins, they want Congress to pass national paid maternity leave. But these don't have a snowball's chance in hell, because of the power of wealthy donors, business lobbyists. So my feeling is that there can be reforms at the state and local level because of the fine work of people like you, but unless there's public campaign financing, very little is going to be done at the national level in terms of passing pro-worker legislation. So I was out in Seattle and they have this fascinating new, this was passed by initiative. So every citizen of Seattle gets a $100 voucher when they fill out their local taxes, and they could contribute that voucher to the candidate of their choice. So that, so that means, 1,000 people, maybe poor people, can contribute $100,000, and that could equal what the rich Microsoft or Amazon exec is going to give. And that's a really interesting idea, and they say that's even better than what exists in New York, which I think we have a 6-to-1 match. But if you're too poor to really give any money, that match doesn't mean anything to you.
Question in the back?
Thank you. I had a question. I practice both traditional labor law and wage and hour law, working a lot with low-wage immigrant workers. And the NLRA, obviously, for a lot of the reasons you've discussed, has a lot of problems for groups of workers that worker centers focus on. Although the board has been doing what it can, I think, in the past couple years in particular, to support workers' rights to organize, which is what the Act says, including making trying to make elections quicker and expanding, for example, the definition of joint employment, which we see a lot in some of these on-demand economy cases, for example. But you know, I still think that there's a long way to go that would require real statutory change for these groups of workers. And I'm just wondering if folks have thoughts on whether just these changes that have happened in the last couple of years would make organizing under the Act any more attractive, especially given a lot of worker centers' resistance and employers' accusations that worker centers are quote-unquote labor organizations that can really bind them and bind their organizing for some of the reasons you've talked about and subject them to other liability. So is that sort of still too big of an obstacle for a lot of worker centers or other alt labor organizations to want to pursue the route under the NLRA?
I'm not quite sure what the question was, but let me take a stab at it. First of all, in terms of what changes in board law over the last few years, I guess I always respond by saying that the changes have been modest but meaningful. The changes are not, in my view, dramatic or radical. I don't think the board is able to do radical for all the reasons that I explained. That just it's not possible within this statute. But it can make changes which are meaningful and make things a little bit easier. I think in the realm of non-union collective activity, and one of the things that struck me when I was at the board was how many cases actually involve spontaneous worker conduct without a union, without a worker center, without any other organization other than a group of workers coming together to try to fix some problem. Maybe they stand in the parking lot for 14 hours, and then there's a legal issue that's raised because they don't get off the property. But basically, the law is open and receptive and protects this kind of conduct by workers. I think part of the problem is that, somebody alluded to this, that workers don't know they have these rights. Many attorneys at whom they might go to wouldn't even think to go to the NLRA because I think it's a great secret that this law actually protects non-union workers. People just think it's all about unions. But there are clearly rights. And the law is not that complicated or controversial in this area of what's protected. And there are not all that many dissenting opinions, as a matter of fact, in these cases. There might be some disagreements about whether some conduct exceeded the protection of the law because, for example, what I just said, you stayed in the parking lot too long beyond the numerous warnings that you were given to leave the premises. So there might be questions like that, but the basic conceptual framework of what's protected, what's concerted, is not that, it's pretty formed in the law. To move to the other part of your question, which is that I don't know the reasons that some worker centers are so adamant about not being unions. I don't know whether it's because they don't want to be subject to secondary boycott. I don't know whether it's because they don't really want to have to file the reports with the Department of Labor. But I've been in many groups where I've heard people absolutely insist they're not a labor organization, they don't want to be a labor organization. Coalition of Immokalee Workers, I've heard them say, we're not a union, we're not a worker center, we're a human rights organization, and this is what we want to be. So I do think that there are different strategies, different objectives that the different organizations have. I think many times they can work collaboratively with labor organizations. Sometimes I think there may be some clashes in terms of strategy and objective. I'll give you an example of that, that the president of the Farm Labor Organizing Committee, which is a labor organization, believes very strongly that, and he's the first to say, I don't want to be covered by the NLRA because then I couldn't do secondary boycotts, but he believes very strongly that workers need freedom of association rights, that that's the only way, really, in the long run, to make sure that farm workers have decent living conditions, that they have clean housing and clean water and supplies of water, and that there isn't child labor working in the tobacco fields, for example. He said, unless you have an organization that's ongoing. So he would take issue, for example, with the Coalition of Immokalee Workers model, not with their achievements, but with the model that doesn't include freedom of association and ongoing representation. So I'm not sure exactly where you're going with the question, but I do think they are different models. How long they can sustain themselves is certainly the non-union model is a different question, but I think right now what we have is a mosaic, and all these different organizations contribute something a little bit different. I think they're, for the most part, quite complementary, but I do think they're different.
I just want to follow up with one thing, which is on the question of the meaningful, modest but meaningful. You know, the election, because I think part of the question was elections reform. And I have to say, you know, like I said, in SEIU, we do not run elections, especially in my division, in the building service division, we do not run elections very often. We did recently have an election for airport workers, and we got to that election in 3 weeks. We could have gotten to that election in 2 weeks, I think, if we had not had the multi-site unit that we had, which created some difficulties in terms of figuring out the place in the scheduling. And also, the other thing is that it was difficult to figure out where to do the actual election because the employer, which is the contractor, doesn't control anything at the airport. They don't have a room where they could give us, or that they could give the government to actually conduct the election. So that created some delay. But apart from that, it moved very quickly, and I do think that is pretty meaningful. Now, back to one of the things that you said at the very beginning, which is, that the law is not a substitute for organizing, I would echo that, and I would also add the law doesn't lead. The law is not a substitute for organizing, and it doesn't lead change, in my view. It is a tool that can be used for change. And I think, the election changes are an example of that. It is very meaningful. Having a single unit in an airport, if you think about it, is an example of how by itself that's still modest and that it's not going to lead anything, because the reality is until we can represent a majority of people at any particular airport, a majority of workers at any particular airport who are in a similar situation, we're not going to be able to bargain the economics at that airport. So we still face a lot of challenges. But it is meaningful.
So about a year ago, I was talking to Greg Asbed, one of the founders of the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, and he said all these labor unions were telling him, you should try to become a union. And he said, well, we're excluded from the National Labor Relations Act. California is the only state that really gives farm workers a right to unionize. But so Greg told me that they went out and got thousands and thousands of farm workers to sign pro-union cards. And they presented them to the growers, and the growers basically said, get lost. So I think Greg and the Coalition of Immokalee Workers went through that exercise just to show that the traditional union route really doesn't work very well, and they've very successfully used other techniques. Then the last part of the gentleman's question, you asked about employers saying that worker centers are wrongfully engaged in collective bargaining. I think there's very, very, very little collective bargaining being done by worker centers. I think ROC is the only one I know of, and ROC insists that they're only doing it as part of settlement negotiations and wage theft cases. Maybe you know of other examples. I mean, it's an intellectually interesting question, but I don't think that much is being done.
Question or comment?
Sometimes to articles about, for instance, the Fight for 15, and they're grotesque. It's things like, why should I what you think worker centers could or should be doing to fight that narrative in, you know, maybe a media sense or a journalism sense. Like, what do you think could or should be done to sort of combat that very effective narrative coming from the right?
Well, I feel like I'm looking at Danielle, who's like, oh man, I have some ideas. But I think the thing is like, I actually don't think that we can really appeal to rational argument here, because no, really, I mean, 42% of the workforce makes less than $15 an hour. So clearly a lot of the people that are posting those disgusting comments are either making less than 15 or know somebody who is or are in this low wage economy. And I think that the left and our side has been too quick to be like, here are all of the facts. And it's like, and then the other side goes, okay, yeah, stipulated. I still don't want to pay $15 an hour.
Or they're being paid to post those comments.
Exactly. Yeah. So I kind of think that we have to play in the right sphere, and the right sphere is the sphere of we are going to make irrational arguments, but find a way to make those arguments appeal. You know, like, and it's not just on worker stuff, although, you know, we can talk about worker stuff, but we're going to make irrational arguments that if we raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour, then, you know, somebody's going to come and steal your children, which is, like, really, I mean, like, they are, like, their arguments just make no sense, but they have this narrative that works for them, and I wish I could, I have examples that I can think of, but it's more of just, it's playing on a much more emotional level, and unfortunately to say, not always emotional level of, you know, these workers are being abused, because honestly, people don't care about that. I mean, I think that's part of the message, but I think it's much more appealing to people's self-interest and irrationality, and I don't know, I feel like that's the conclusion I've come to.
Let me just add, I'm sorry. So people who've been around a long time, like Wilma and me, you know, so, in strikes in the 1980s, you know, construction workers were making a lot more money than the average American, steel workers, auto workers, and a lot of Americans resented that. They thought these are spoiled folks, yeah. And some of those unions were largely white, and they thought unions were greedy. And I think one of the, you know, brilliant aspects of the Justice for Janitors campaign is they said, we're going to turn the traditional labor fight into a fight for economic justice and do it very openly, overtly, and actively. And since Justice for Janitors, we've really seen a change in tone when labor is pushing for higher wages. This is, you know, it's justice, justice, justice. Yeah. When you look at the any of the media, social media done by Fight for 15, they'll have a, you know, $8.25 worker in Tennessee complaining that, you know, I work 50 hours a week and I can't feed my kids. And it's much more effective than when, you know, the $40 an hour steelworkers went on strike in 1980.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think that there's a lot of people, I didn't know the statistic, the 42%, but I know that there are a lot of people who are at $15 or less or hovering around there. And I think it's a lot about whether they see themselves as part, a recipient of the benefit of Fight for 15 or somehow disadvantaged by the Fight for 15. We have to make people understand that they're going to be a beneficiary regardless of whether they actually are the fast food worker on the picket line or not. And that's, I think, the challenge to us.
Okay, hunger is setting in, but let's have one final.
I think we had two people waiting.
Oh, okay.
First, saw a hand over here.
This question is for Steve. I want to know, in your experience, why do you think there is a race to the bottom in this country? Because I find that quite fascinating that people, like if somebody has a benefit, instead of saying, I would like to have that, they would say, why do they have it? You should not have that.
Eight different answers. Where do I begin? So my mother, bless her memory, so she, you know, she grew up in the 1930s. And she saw unions in the 30s and 40s, you know, get, you know, big wage increases. You know, the auto workers, steel workers, those greedy folks. No, and then late 40s and 50s got these, you know, path-breaking health benefits, pension benefits. And my mother said, you know, when she was growing up, people would say, "Look what those union members got. That's great. We want them too." And I remember I was out in Wisconsin covering Scott Walker, trying to hobble public sector unions. I was talking to my mother on the phone, and you know, I'd written that Scott Walker quote, the public sector workers are the haves, you know, the average Wisconsinite, you know, the average taxpayers, the have-nots. And I remember my mother said, you know, America has really changed. Now people resent unions for having what they have, and they want unions to, like, be knocked down many pegs. Another thing is, you know, I'm reading this new book by Tom Kokin, an MIT labor relations professor, and, you know, he really, you know, walks us through step by step how the mentality of corporate America has changed. You know, and you know, he talks about the 1949 graduating class of Harvard Business School, and they, you know, all fought in World War II together, and the rich guys and the poor guys, and there weren't women in the trenches, I'm sorry. You know, there was a real solidarity, and that when these people graduated from business school in 1949, you know, they wanted to help all stakeholders, and they were, like, much more generous, much more, you know, indulgent, accommodating, you know, concerned about all the workers. And he has, Cochran has, like, this 1990 statement and this 1997 statement from the Business Roundtable. The 1990 statement says, you know, we corporations, you know, have to watch out for all stakeholders. And by 1997, it's all profit maximization, profit maximization. So, you know, going back 100 years, you know, 100 years, you know, folks in the New York garment industry are moving jobs and industry to Wilma's Philadelphia in search of lower wages. And then in the 50s and 60s, it was to the South. In the 70s and 80s and 90s, it was to Japan and China, and now China. So there has been this long-term move to follow the low road. And as unions have weakened, there's been less push to pressure them to follow a higher road.
Please join me in thanking our panelists.